Have you ever heard what existence is? Well, you're going to hear it right now. Existence is literally a simulation of loss being presented by mind to spirit. And the simulation of loss is designed to bring spirit to the point where it accepts its own annihilation. And from the acceptance of its own annihilation is supposed to arise some sort of magic that after spirit is annihilated, that spirit out of the ashes, out of nothing, will arise a new spirit. And this new spirit will be the prime creator of a new creation. This is the fantasy, this is the tale that is being told by mind to spirit, which is what we call existence, this simulation of loss. The key here is spirit is trying to learn how to accept its own annihilation. Acceptance for spirit is the key. That is supposedly the magic that will bring about a rising of a new spirit once spirit accepts its own annihilation. This is the core teaching of what is really taking place in existence. Now, it's all a fantasy. It's all a simulation. It's all a hypothetical scenario. It's all a dream. It's all imagination. It has no relevance to reality whatsoever. So we're sort of in a nightmare, is what it's really like. It's like a nightmare where we suffer loss, 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 loss. If you actually are honest about the world and you start ticking off all the losses in your life and everything you've lost, you'll be astonished. And you look at others and see everything that they've lost, you will be absolutely astonished. And you can't draw any conclusion other than to say, you know what, this world, its sole purpose is loss. It gives us things and only to take away. So why is it this way? Because it's trying to teach spirit to let this lesson of accepting loss, ultimately accepting its own annihilation. Now, why would this whole crazy thing be in place? This is the question people would say. People can go so far and say, yes, we see the loss. Yes, it's possible. All is possible. Then they say, but why? But why? And the answer to that is very simple. We're not going to throw up our hands and say it's a mystery. Not here. The answer is very simple. Spirit chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator. Spirit says, I want to be prime creator instead of accept my place in creation as the Son of God. I want to be God. So, in choosing this idea, how can mind present this to spirit? It's impossible. Spirit, reality can't be changed at all. Completely impossible to accomplish this. So how does mind present this idea? It says to spirit, oh, yes, you can accomplish it. But here's the way. And, of course, if spirit were to be prime creator, that means reality would have to be completely changed. There wouldn't be any more reality. Reality is one indivisible whole with a fixed will. And if that's gone, there is no more reality at all. So no more reality equals spirit's annihilation. So mind has to say to spirit, spirit, there's a way to do it. You have to be annihilated. But, and spirit says, well, wait a minute, if I'm annihilated, there's nothing more. How can I be prime creator then? And mind says, ah, but there's some magic, and I'll tell you what that is. And it says, if you can accept your annihilation instead of rejecting it, you accept it and say, yes, I accept it, then somehow that acceptance provides a magical miracle where you are born again as new spirit, as prime creator. And this is what is taking place. This is the why all of this loss, this simulation of loss is taking place by mind. This is why. Spirit wants to be prime creator. And this is what mind presents, and this is what mind tells spirit. Of course it's all a lie. Of course it's all deception. There's no truth to it whatsoever. But what else can mind do? Mind is the presenter of ideas, the spirit. So what else can mind do but say, of course I can do this, spirit. Here's how we're going to do it. And again, mind can't do it. It's impossible. So it has to resort to this magic, saying, well, first you have to be annihilated. And then you just have to have faith that accepting your annihilation, you will be born again, you know, resurrected from the dead. And you will then be able to rule over all creation as prime creator. What else can mind say? It's absolute fairy tale nonsense. That's all it can come up with, though. It basically says it's impossible, but once you accept the impossibility of it, then it becomes possible. So it's like it's acceptance is some kind of miracle, right? The mind says, oh, there's a miracle that will accomplish this, and it's your acceptance of it. And Jerry says, huh, how can I learn to accept this? You know, how can I, what is this power, what does acceptance mean? What is this, in reality, what does acceptance mean? It's nonsense. There's nothing, reality doesn't need to accept itself. It is what it is. So Spirit's trying to figure out, how can I learn to accept loss and ultimately accept my own annihilation? And mind says, well, there's a way, and there's this training ground. And Spirit says, where? I don't see any training ground. The mind says, ah, but you haven't been looking in the right place. And Spirit says, why? Well, where is that? And then mind says, okay. The Spirit says, okay, just believe that there is such a place. And so Spirit says, okay, I'm suspending my, trying to just allow my, open my mind to it, open my, accept that there maybe is such a place. And then, ah, they see it. Mind presents a dream. An imaginary scenario, a simulation. And Spirit says, oh my gosh, I never saw this before. Where did this come from? You know, wow. And mind says, ah, you weren't looking for it. But now that you look for it, there it is, you see. So Spirit says, oh my gosh, I was in reality. I didn't even know this was existed. And now I see this whole vast scenario. And I didn't know it. I didn't see it before. That's because it's a dream. That's because it's a dream. And mind told Spirit to suspend any rationale, any reason, any reality, suspend it, and somehow you will go into this state. It's like a hypnotic state of dreaming. So it's like mind is suggesting to Spirit that Spirit sees this, and Spirit says, oh yeah, I do see it. Yeah, I see it. It's like a hallucination, essentially. What Spirit has done is simply hallucinating. Our mind is presenting this hallucination, it's presenting suggestions, perhaps. And Spirit's hallucinating, saying, yeah, I see all this impermanence. Wow, what do I do with this? And then mind says, Spirit, here is the great training ground which will teach you how to accept your own annihilation, so you can then magically be reborn as Prime Creator. And Spirit says, wow, incredible. Look at this, a whole kingdom of impermanence, a whole incredible training ground. How do I get started? And then mind says, okay, we'll get started bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. Gradually, we'll practice loss. So here we are, identifying with this human form of loss, and we are able to sort of consider what's going on. And this, their hypnosis then becomes either intense or lessens during this pivotal time of human identification, with identification with human loss. We pick up this feeling of like, wait a minute, we can either go all in on loss at this point and try to get the ultimate lesson of accepting annihilation, or we can, what is that shadow going? Huh, what was that going over the face of the camera there? Interesting, where did that come from? Something on the lens or something? Wow. You see that little sort of dark shadowy thing, area that came over? We can either accept our loss, go intensely into it, or say, wait a minute, this whole thing is a scam. It's just a hypnotic scam. I'm hallucinating. This is not true. This is not a reality. This is all a training ground, an attempt to accomplish the impossible. There is no magical resurrection from the annihilation of Spirit. And in fact, Spirit can't be annihilated. So there's no annihilation of Spirit. There's no magical resurrection from Spirit's annihilation. All of this is just a tall tale told by mind as a way to reassure Spirit that, yes, Spirit can become Prime Creator, but Spirit cannot. So the remedy is to simply exchange this desire to be Prime Creator for desire to accept reality as it is. And then instead of having the simulation of loss, you have the simulation of no loss. Now that, wherever it was that was in front of the camera that caused the shadow, it's not come back. It's in my hand. There's nothing there. Interesting. Well, there's another foreshadowing. I'm having so much foreshadowing going on right now that it's alarming. It's just like incredible. It's all has to do with black darkness. My clothes are getting stained right and left with big blotches of dark black blackness. My shirt was ruined recently. My pants got terrible stains all over the upper pocket and leg. My glove today had this black, starry, sticky substance. I said, where in the heck did that come from? And at least I was wearing gloves. It didn't get on my hand. Here's the glove. It's a left-handed glove, actually. I don't know if you can see. I got the light turned up. There's a black, tarry substance on the glove. Constantly, this foreshadowing of a very dark substance coming. See, there's a stain on my shirt. And it's all spread out all over the shirt, and the one on the pants you can't see as well. I got the light boosted up pretty high. There's some of the stain on the pants, but it goes all the way down the leg. And this is after washing it with all sorts of pre-wash and stain removers and everything. Can't remove the stain. Can't remove it. Black birds flying right over like this, going underneath my truck, is just an incredible constellation of foreshadowing. And it's all darkness. It's all black. It's all stains. It's all stuff you can't get out. And then that shadow going over my face like that, you know, it's like, there's another one. It's really something. So I've been trying to figure out what it is, and there is most definitely loss coming. And again, what my purpose here is to help people center in truth, and to know that there's a remedy, and to not be pulled into this cyclonic, great cyclone of fear which is going to arise. By seeing what existence really is and acknowledging it, there's a tremendous freedom from it. It's amazing how I'm able to see how unappealing the world is now, and how I've been trapped in all this simulations of loss, thinking that it was important. And I can see just how utterly dastardly the world is, but it doesn't cause depression. Oh, I see how it is now. Of course, what do you expect? It's a simulation of loss designed to teach spirit how to accept its own annihilation. That is what existence is. And, you know, it's a gradual realization, because we're afraid we'll get depressed. And so we kind of have the disillusionment happens bit by bit by bit. But I can tell you that disillusionment is happening very rapidly for me now, and it's not causing it's causing a little depression, but not serious. I'm kind of, you know, glum and downcast at times. I just realize, oh my gosh there's another. Just look at the history of the planet, the world, life lost. You say everything, you're losing everything. You see, everything is slipping through your fingers, and you start cataloging and thinking about it. You say, it's right, that is true, my gosh, this is nothing but loss. We're identifying here with a form that suffers so much loss, so much devastating loss. The human form, it suffers the most loss, most terrible, heart-wrenching types of loss. And in a sophisticated situation in the world right now, the loss has become even worse, even more incredible. And you can just, every facility that you have, every benefit, everything, it seems to be slipping through your fingers right now. And the future seems like it's just one big loss, that we're going to just lose everything. Everything's going to be snarled up and so chaotic and so confusing, and the laws are going to become so incredibly difficult that the cronyism is the only way to survive. And you're losing all your ideals, you're losing all your hopes, you're all losing everything, all the hopes for fairness and playing by the rules, etc., is all gone. And it becomes cronyism and thugism and gangsterism and all those kind of things. It becomes very, very dark, very, very dark time. Losing all your hope for a lightened world, for a wonderful world. That's just one example of what we're losing now. But it's across the board. You're losing your health, you're losing your senses, you're losing your money, you're losing your affluence, you're losing, you're aging, you're going to lose your life. But those are, that just scratches the surface. If you go into it, you will begin to realize, you know, just how much loss takes place in a lifetime. It is incredible how much loss, how many dashed hopes, for instance, I've had. And I've seen all these scams that have been run on me only to create a feeling of loss. So there's been an intense effort to get me to feel extreme loss in my life. Extreme loss. Because that's the game here, is the idea that you can be, the ego's idea of salvation, the mind's idea in the context of this, of spirit wanting to be prime creator, its idea is by accepting your annihilation, you will be reborn and be saved. So that's its salvation. Accept your own annihilation is its version of salvation. So when I said, hey, I want to be saved, I want to tell people about salvation, the world mind automatically twisted that and said, well, if you want to help us, you yourself have to be saved first, and therefore you have to go through your own annihilation. So I did go to the point of total mental chaos, and then I realized that's not salvation. It's nothing. You cannot abide in that, and it's not annihilation, but it's total suffering, mental chaos. And I said, wow, how crazy, it doesn't work. And from that point, then I turned around and said, hey, this whole thing is a scam. This is what's taking place in the world. In existence is a complete scam. It doesn't work, will never work. And we have to find what salvation really is, because what we're being told is salvation is not, absolutely is not, it doesn't work. And there's no way to make it work. So I've been gradually jettisoning all of that terrible stuff, but the loss has just been horrible. The mind sets you up and says you're going to succeed this way, and then you believe in it, and it fails, and you have this terrible feeling of failure and loss, that you've lost your opportunity, and then it does it again and again and again and again and again. So it's just absolutely diabolical. This whole scheme is completely diabolical in terms of just torturing us with loss, many kinds of loss that people don't even recognize. Oftentimes you have hopes, right? Your hopes are built up and then dashed. That's a severe loss right there. Now, what I have said, and I stick to this, is that we are going to have a problem with space rocks, okay? That over and over and over throughout my life, this has been the theme. If I get into it, it'll be incredible. You won't even believe it, how much reinforcement I've gotten for this theme, that there is going to be some impact on this planet of space rocks, bringing about perhaps a huge dust cloud, which might be like a huge cloud of darkness, which may be the foreshadowing we're seeing here of a cloud of darkness. And it is going to cause a terrible rotting and a lot of troubles. However, instead of freaking out about it, we can say, okay, let us be disillusioned about the world and what its purpose is. Accept what its purpose is, knowing that we can choose the simulation of non-loss, of no loss. With simple mind and spirit can simply say, oh, I know what this is all about, and I know how to sidestep it. I just choose the simulation of non-loss, of no loss. And I've been shown an entire world domain, a living place where there's no loss whatsoever. I was taken in spirit and I saw it. I experienced it. There's not a trace of loss anywhere. And I just said, wow, how is this possible? What's going on? And I had to come to terms with that fact. So that is how you sidestep it. You choose the simulation of no loss. The benefit of accepting the world as it is that then you can say, oh, okay, I can exchange it. I just see what it is. It's a wretched, dirty dishcloth, and let me exchange it for some nice, fresh hand towel or something. You know, it's just as simple. You say, oh, okay. When we don't have any illusions about the world, it's easy to exchange it. But if we think, oh no, this world is so wonderful, it's so beautiful, it's so nice, it's so sweet, and all this sugar-coated nonsense about it, then we'll hold on to it, and say, oh no, this is precious, and we won't exchange it, and then we'll suffer the loss. So you have the mind has sent a veritable armada of entities into this world this time to try to sugarcoat this world and give us this feeling that we're supposed to hold on to it instead of the wisdom of disillusionment about this world, of speaking the truth. I was brought up in the 60s, and what we had, the attitude we had was speak truth to authority. Okay, speak truth to authority. And so I have always tried to do that. And what is the authority that we should speak truth to? The mind and spirit. Spirit's wanting to be prime creator, choosing that idea, and mind presenting it. That's the authority we need to speak truth to. And it's the Holy Spirit speaks truth to spirit. The Holy Spirit's not afraid to speak truth to spirit and say, Spirit, you need to repent. You need to repent. So it's the Holy Spirit that has educated me. It's the real education on this planet is the education the Holy Spirit will give you. And it's an individualized curriculum. It's not something that can be presented externally as some external curriculum. It's an internal, individualized, custom-made curriculum where the Holy Spirit educates you about the world, about existence, about spirit, about mind, about what's going on here. That is the true education. And then you can be disillusioned to the point where you just say, I'm not going to get caught up in that stuff anymore. I know it's only, everything I get a hold of in this world is only for the purpose of losing it. Of losing it. Of course, we can't suffer. We can't practice suffering loss unless we first have something to lose, right? So, of course, we are given stuff, given a body, given health, supposedly, and then we lose it. And then we're given it again, we lose it again. So whatever we get, inevitably we're going to lose it. And loss comes in many, 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 many different guises. Many guises. You can lose a culture. You can use a culture. You can lose a sensibility in the world. You can have a sort of a kindness in the world, and you lose that. It becomes very harsh, as we have now. You can have a decency, and things become extremely indecent. You can lose that. You can have good times, and you lose them. Become very, very dark times. You can have good health. You can lose that and have terrible sickness. You can have friends, and you can lose your friends. You can have families. Families will get split up. You can have partners. You lose a partner. You can have jobs. You lose a job. Whatever it is, you have a car. Eventually, that car is falling apart, and you're going to lose that car. You have a pet, a dog. You're going to lose that dog. Everything here in this world is loss. Everything. Everything. So, and the mind is an expert at applying all these torture tactics, because not because it's to blame, but it's because spirit says, hey, I want to become prime creator. So it's mind, your job is to find the way to make me prime creator. So mind has no choice but to say, okay, spirit, you have to accept your own annihilation. And again, spirit says, how do I do that? Mind says, we have to train you. So all this horrible stuff we've gone through in existence. And if any one of us goes through it, all of us is going through it. So all this horrible stuff we have all gone through, it's simply the training, mind trying to train spirit to accept his own annihilation. That's it. We look at all the famines throughout history, all the terrible plagues, all the terrible wars, and just the misery and drudgery of life, and then in the boredom, and the mental, emotional, physical problems, the displacements, the disappointments, and the struggle, and just the everything we've gone through on this planet. And you can go on and on and on and on and on. And here we are, thinking that finally we got it made. Look out. That's the point in time when mind will really drop the big bomb on the whole thing. In other words, just blow the whole thing up and, you know, maybe send an asteroid in, or a couple asteroids in, and really cause severe loss. So make all loss previously seem like, oh, that wasn't hardly anything. And mind says, mind will call it a benediction to you and say, finally you're getting this blessing where you have the final lesson of severe loss, and that will teach you, spirit, to accept your own annihilation. And spirit says, oh wow, thank you, mind, this is very helpful for me. And that's, you know, the foolish spirit, uneducated by the Holy Spirit, will take it that way and say, this is necessary, this is helpful, and out of this, we're going to be able to become prime creator. We're going to learn how to accept our own annihilation. But first, we have to have all these bodies and things and civilization, all this stuff, lose it all and accept that loss. And that will empower us then to accept our own annihilation, and then we'll arise miraculously from that acceptance as a new spirit. Okay, never will happen. Never happen, Spirit. No possibility of that ever happening. So it's useless. Going through this loss is useless, which is why I say sidestep it. It's useless. It's just suffering. It's just terrible trauma and suffering, and it doesn't provide the magic lesson. It does not. So in sidestepping it, in going into a situation, a simulation of no loss, you don't have loss taking place. And depending on your orientation, that's either good or scary. If you understand what I'm talking about here, you'll say, ah, wonderful. I don't need to learn any lessons of loss. Let me dwell in this place of simulation of no loss, and that will bridge the continuity issue to reality. I'll be able to set down all simulations then. Whereas if you think you need to learn how to accept your own annihilation, you will look around and say, oh my God, there's no lessons here. I can't learn anything here. I'm going to fail to accept my own annihilation, and my annihilation might happen to me without my acceptance, and then I won't be resurrected, you see, and I'll be annihilated forever. So I have to work on acceptance, and there's no way to do it here because there's no loss anywhere. So you will refuse to go to such a situation. You will refuse. So that is why it's so crucial here to understand what's being said. It's crucial for me to understand this because I'm certainly oriented in that direction. I've been prepared for that and am working to share this and help others go in the same direction. It's not necessary that one have already, you know, dropped all resistance. It's only necessary that one gets it in general sense of it and say, yeah, that's what I want. I get a general sense of what's being said. And it's not difficult to understand. It's not difficult to understand. And my purpose here has been to simplify it to the point where it becomes crystal clear and you can see it and say, ah, okay, I can either choose to continue on with the simulation of loss or I can choose the simulation of non-loss. Just a simple choice. The simulation of loss is designed to train me how to finally accept my own annihilation so I can then magically be resurrected as Prime Creator, a new creation, the new source of a new creation. And that can never happen. So all the simulation of loss is simply nothing. It's completely futile. It's a complete waste to spend any attention on it, to go through any of these lessons. The lessons will never bear fruit. So you see that, and then you say the simulation of no loss helps me bridge the continuity gap with reality, because reality, there's no loss in reality. So if I choose that, I will be gradually reconciled to reality. And that's the only lesson I really need to learn. So it's simple like that. And the fear comes up, of the fear of no loss, the simulation of no loss, because you think there's no opportunity to suffer loss and I can't learn this lesson of how to accept my own annihilation. And then you say, wait a minute, I don't need to learn to accept my own annihilation. And say, oh, okay, so I don't need these lessons. Oh, okay. You see, and then it turns it around. I don't need to learn how to accept my own annihilation because I'll never be annihilated. It's impossible for a spirit to be annihilated. So I don't need any lessons in loss. I don't need them. But most people still are thinking that it's imperative that they get more lessons because they're not there yet. They say, you know, I just haven't learned how to accept my own annihilation yet, so I need more lessons. So they're looking forward to these lessons to come. And they'll certainly get them. They will certainly get them. One moment here. I have some. All right. The world is always doom and gloom, actually. To speak the truth about the world, it's always doom and gloom. Interesting enough, today is the 7-4s, which spell out perfect disaster, actually. It's a foreshadowing of what's to come. For example, speaking of 44s, the Irish potato famine, actually, they say it began in 44, and it manifested in full strength in 45, but it was present, somehow it had been brought over in 44, is what I understand. Terrible blight, everything suddenly, you know, dying, the potato famine, terrible potato famine. 44, very, very ominous number, actually, in today's 7-4s in the world. 44th president of the U.S. in office, 4 years, 4 months, and 4 days. On the 24th of May, 7-4s. So, now, another foreshadowing is on August 18th, 1999, I became aware that the dimensional barriers had collapsed in this world, allowing the fourth dimensional mindset to have unimpeded access to this world, which means that there would be a subjugation taking place. I was told that the subjugation would be completed in 15 years. So, we would be at the end of August 15th, 2014, would actually be the end of the, would be the 15th year, the end of the 15th year. Or that would complete the 15-year cycle. That would complete it. So, we could be looking at the next year and several months, actually, as a time of the completion of the subjugation of this planet. And this could be the time, either we're going to have a severe problems within this time frame of the next, say, May, June, July, August, like the next 3 months, three and 12 is 15 months, actually. So it could actually be the next 15 months. Could either be a time of tremendous trouble, or it could be the precursor after that period. Would be the tremendous trouble in this world. So we either have 15 more months that where we're going to just gradually, you know, sink into this morass. One second. Or we have 15 months of severe beatdown taking place now to complete the subjugation within this 15-year period. Dimensional barriers, here's an example. Take like the Woodstock Festival. You have organizers, they want to make money. They set up a concert, they have fencing around, and they expect everybody to play by the rules, to buy tickets, and to get in line, like third dimensionals do. We follow the rules of fairness and fair play. And what happens is all these people descend on the Woodstock, and they start pushing the fences down. And the organizers cannot, they don't have enough people to keep the fences up. And before you know it, the fences have come down and everybody just pours in, a million people, and all the people don't have tickets at all. They just all pour in. It's like that. Dimensional barriers are basically a mindset of agreed upon rules and regulations and what we will accept and what we won't. And when those barriers drop, then you become susceptible to those who don't play by the rules. Let's say you have certain rules and others don't play by those rules. When you relax those your rules and to a certain extent, or they're pushed down to a certain extent, they'll collapse and will accept. Then the new, those barbarians can come in who don't play by the rules at all, make up their own rules, whatever. They come in and subjugate the place. So the planet Earth has been under this incredible subjugation for the last 13 plus years. And it's to the point now where subjugation is going to be completed. The fourth dimensionals are going to subjugate this planet. They have different rules. They play by their own rules. They don't play by the rules that third dimensionals have set up. They take great delight in subverting all these rules and getting around them and sneering at them and trashing these rules that we've set up for our civilization. So that has been happening severely, and it may be that the beatdown is the next 15 months, severe beatdown, or it may be that the third dimension will totter along for another 15 months and then really collapse after that. But I would say the beatdown will begin, but we will find out. It's hard to pinpoint exactly exact time frame as far as this goes, but I wouldn't be surprised at all if the beatdown happens very, very quickly, where the fourth dimensionals gain complete control of this planet and they're playing by their own rules now, and the third dimension just collapses. You know how they do that bread and circuses? They keep everybody distracted by entertainment and junk food, And people don't even care anymore. They don't even pay attention. They don't even know what's going on. They don't care as long as they have some more special effects on television. You know, some drama. Bunch of drama and screaming on the television. They'll be looking at it. Oh, what the hell is happening? Someone screaming, you know, and not paying attention. And so most of the people on the planet, not even paying attention. They don't even care, seem to care. So it's only a question of how quickly does the fourth dimension consolidate their power at this point. And I would say after this date of the seven fours, it will happen very quickly and be quite severe. Quite severe. There'll be some false flag, Reichstag fire, something that'll enable them to grab a hold of the power here and crush the opposition, the will of the opposition, and the crushing will happen. I'm afraid it'll happen very severely and quickly. Through some pretext or another. So, this is the way existence works. This is the way the simulation of loss works. It's vicious. It's completely vicious. And it has to be, because it's trying to teach spirit what's impossible to teach spirit. And so it hides the impossibility of it by increasing the viciousness and intensity of it, you see. Because then spirit will say, well, it's never worked before, but oh look, here's a new intensity. Maybe this new intensity will work. That kind of thing. So it strings spirit along, saying, oh, yes, spirit, the stuff hasn't worked yet because you haven't been ready for the real stuff. But now you're ready for it, so it's going to be more intense now. Spirit will say, oh, I see, okay. That's how it works. So it's liable to be more intense now. And that's spirit's still buying into that, oh, greater intensity, okay, that must be the answer. Because spirit thinks that it's failing. Spirit says, wow, I really failed to learn how to accept my own annihilation. I don't know what's wrong. And mind says, well, you haven't failed yet. If you just hang in there, you'll see, find a new intensity, and that will help you succeed. And spirit says, oh, okay, I'll buy that. But the Holy Spirit says, don't buy that, that's nonsense. That's nonsense. Truth is not at the mercy of intensity. Okay? Truth is not at the mercy of intensity. So, whatever happens in the world of this intensity of loss, we can simply say, I'm not buying that this is helpful at all for me. I'm not buying it. I'm buying the simulation of no loss. That's what I'm buying. Because the Holy Spirit told me that this is the right move to make. And the Holy Spirit has explained to me what existence is very clearly, and I accept it, and I've seen that the Holy Spirit speaks truly. So I accept what it's saying, that intensity has no issue at all. It doesn't have no effect on reality whatsoever. Just like reality is not the mercy of consensus. We can't take a vote and decide what's real. It's not at the mercy of anything, including intensity. So intense loss is no more useful to us than non-intense loss. It's the same, equally futile, but we get strung along by intensity. Thinking that, oh, maybe this is it, if we just have a real whopper, we're going to succeed. Yeah. So we don't have to be that stupid. It is gross stupidity, really. It's suspension of sanity, isn't it? Because we want to believe, we say, oh, of course, intensity, that must be it. And we don't even think. Say, wait a minute, is truth really at the mercy? Or is reality at the mercy of intensity? We don't even think about it. The Holy Spirit just simply tells us, hey, think about this stuff. You know, consider it. At least give it some consideration, that's all. It's not tough to understand. All you have to do is say, now, wait a minute, let me consider this. Let me ponder on this. Let me ponder on this and say, is that really true? Is truth really at the mercy of something? Intensity, duration, consensus, whatever? Belief, imagination, hypotheticals, simulations? Is it really at the mercy of all this or not? Maybe it's not. At least we consider and say, maybe it's not. Maybe it's not at the mercy of any of this. So, if we can at least consider this in our minds and say, yeah, let me give us this consideration, I feel like I can do that, then we can be saved. We can be saved from these troubles. We don't have to be completely there. We don't have to be an expert completely there and have no resistance at all. No, that'd be ridiculous. Criteria or bar to get over. But if we just say, you know what, yeah, I believe I can consider this stuff, and that's what I want. Variation of non-loss. I don't know if it has some sort of variations on it, that how exactly that works, but I've gotten the sense that it's enough to have the willingness to move in that direction, to sidestep the situations that are to come. Some say that a comet will trigger the sun, an intense coronal mass ejection. Or some will say that a comet will come and hit the Earth, or an asteroid will come and hit the Earth, etc., etc. Something is going to impact the planet, I would say. That will have like a domino effect on the planet. It is really a domino effect that's coming. Speaking of darkness, dominoes are black, aren't they? So there's a domino effect coming of darkness. Of black stands for disempowerment. When we talk about getting all these really sticky, dark stuff, disempowerment. But what happens when the electricity goes off? We're in the dark. We can't see. The idea, see, darkness is like saying we can't see anything. We can't see. All the power's off. We can't see. We can't function. So it's relating to disempowerment, and ultimately it relates to loss and death. Death, loss, disempowerment, loss, death. That's what it is. It's darkness, black darkness. And we're definitely headed smack dab into that right now. And again, we can sidestep it. We can sidestep it easily by saying, ah, I don't need these lessons. These lessons are completely useless to me. But the lessons of non-loss are very helpful to me. They solve the continuity problem. So I may sound like a broken record here, but that's what's called for, actually. Right now, the best teaching is to be a broken record and continually to focus in on what's most important instead of getting off on too many tangents. Focus on what's most important. Be the broken record. So Memorial Day, heading into summer, and it could be quite a summer, actually. This period of time coming up has all the elements are there. The whole thing, you can see it's set up, it's poised for something. The fourth dimensionals are feeling the last gasp of third dimensionality right now on this planet. The last resistance, as it were. And don't be surprised if the fourth dimensionals decide to apply the coup de grace on third dimensional resistance at this point. They could very well do that. They could play their ace in the hole, coup de grace, and crush the third dimensional will entirely at this point. They don't want them to get any momentum, any hope that, hey, maybe they can come back. So they may very well use their ace card, which could be, again, an asteroid, a space rock, hitting the planet, something hitting the planet, which I say is intentional. Fourth dimensional is intentionally steering that, causing that situation to take place. Which would, of course, then give the fourth dimensionals complete power over the planet, because they would, what you need is a super control situation at that point of being able to manage everybody on the planet, micromanage everybody as to what to do. And the fourth dimensionals have all this command and control structure of the technology, infrastructure they've made. They have it all ready to go. Everybody can be marked, you know, everybody can receive a mark. Everybody can be monitored at all times. And so that'd be the perfect pretext to utilize all their technology, actually. And so the planet would just say, oh yes, we need you now, we need your help. And they'd say, here we are, okay, we're taking over. Completely. So a perfect pretext to take over. Because the idea is to survive such a thing, all resources would have to be controlled. Everybody would be under rationing. People don't disagree, who disagree with this will be sent to camps, concentration camps. Everything will be monitored. You know, the whole planet will be super have to be super, super, super careful about every move they make. And of course, that's all done by the technology that's in place now. And the technology that's been designed to be utilized in this way. And that's fourth dimensional. So people will easily just say, oh, okay, we need to go along with the program here if we want to survive. But they're leaving out the option of sidestepping this by ascension, dimensional shift, relocation, fifth dimensional, simulation of non-loss. They're not telling you about that. Like a salesman that wants to sell you on something that they want, they leave out the other option, don't they? They leave it out. You never hear them talk about that. Never. They always say, oh no, this is the only place there is, and we're just here to help you. It's not the only place there is. That's a bold-faced lie on their part. And of course, science is saying, oh, we're trying to find some planets. Maybe there's someone out millions of light years. We see maybe there's some place, one that's near a sun, and it's in the right propitious type of situation. And maybe, you know, sort of this kind of loopy, sort of sluggish loopiness, you know, instead of being willing to admit that there are many, many, many dwelling places. We already know about that. It's not some secret knowledge or anything. So they're just playing this ridiculous game with us of delay, as if they're really on the case. And meanwhile, the fourth dimensionals are ready to pounce. And without you knowing what your options are, without you knowing. But remember, the power of choice is within every one of us, and we can choose the simulation of no loss. And that is more powerful than anything. The power of choice is the creativity that we have. And no fourth dimensionals can do anything about it. No third dimensionals, nobody can do anything about it. You choose, you get what you choose. You get what you choose. That's reality. That's the law of God. That's the law of reality. And it has not been suspended. Cannot be suspended. It is still completely operational. We're just not employing it. We've been marketed to not employ that. As if like that's a taboo. Oh no, don't do that. Don't employ the power of choice. Because then you won't learn the lessons of how to accept your own annihilation, and you can never become prime creator. So what? We never could in the first place. So the idea that we don't have the means to accomplish the impossible, what kind of loss is that? That's no loss. So what if we don't have the means? What if we fail at that? We never could accomplish it in the first place, so it's not a failure. And we still have everything. We're still one with reality. We still have everything, so nothing is lost at all. We haven't lost anything. So, but we've been taught that it's some kind of big failure. And we've been told that we'll end up being annihilated and not resurrected, which again is another complete lie. The idea that those who don't accept this acceptance of their own annihilation will be cast down into eternal damnation, eternal hell, and eternal annihilation, and will be their souls will be extinguished. And those who do accept their own annihilation will be magically resurrected from the dead is again a fairy tale. It's absolute nonsense. But that's what, you know, people are nervous about. They say, wow, if I don't keep working to accept my own annihilation, how can I won't be resurrected. Once I'm annihilated, I won't be resurrected. And they're scared of that. There is no annihilation of spirit, none. It's completely impossible. What God created can never be touched, can never be harmed in any way, can never suffer any loss whatsoever, ever, for all eternity. What God created has everything, has endlessness, endless eternal life. So it's utterly ludicrous to play these silly games of thinking that, well, if I don't learn to accept my own annihilation, then I will be permanently annihilated. But if I accept my annihilation, I'll be annihilated, but then I'll be resurrected as a new spirit. Sort of thing. So this utter nonsense. And yet we feel like nervous about that. Okay, now there's a spider going across the viewing screen. That's different. There's a black spider going across the viewing screen, but it didn't show up in the video. The LCD screen here. So there is this lingering fear, like, oh, we need to learn these lessons. No, we don't. No, we don't. And it's very tough to break away from this mindset here on this planet, because people here, they just, we come here for these lessons. Most people do. I did not. I didn't want to come here. I said, I don't want any of these lessons. And got turned all around, etc. And difficult to bring this through in this world, I'll tell you that. Very difficult. And yet here it is, just in time. And it's not difficult to understand. I think everybody can understand it. There's that little spider again, moving up and down. Very good. All right. It's not difficult to understand, if we have the will to understand. But again, that interfere, like, oh, I need these lessons. This will interfere with the lessons. No, you don't need the lessons. Nonsense. Again, you are what you are. Spirit. You are what God created you. I am free. I am as still as God created me. I cannot suffer any loss whatsoever. It's impossible. I can never be annihilated. Therefore, I don't need to learn how to survive annihilation. That's ridiculous. And now you know why, because you think that you want, that's the only way to become prime creator, and to magically believe this. It's a magical belief. It is simply magical belief. It is fantasy. It is make-believe. And there's no punishment. There's no punishment for those who don't learn the lessons of annihilation. There is no punishment. There is no hell. Hell is remaining, is this simulation of loss. That is hell. Remaining loyal to the simulation of loss is remaining in hell. Is remaining in hell, a hellish nightmare of loss. But even that doesn't cause your annihilation at all. It brings about these lessons of loss, of form that you're identifying with, of symbols. All this stuff is symbolic, and like you're identified with it, so you think it's happening to you. You think you're experiencing it. Your spirit feels like, oh my gosh, I'm getting close to loss here. You know, I might be getting close to loss, but it's not getting close at all. How can you get close to the impossible? How can you get close to the impossible happening? How is that possible? Can spirit say, oh, I'm getting close to the impossible happening? It's almost happening. No, it's not. There is no close to the impossible happening. You're always completely, endlessly nothing. You have no point at all. You can't even say that you're far away, because you can't even say you're far away from accomplishing the impossible. It's that you're nothing and nowhere. This whole thing is nowhere. It's nothing and it's nowhere. I am, and this simulation of loss is nothing and nowhere. I am, and this simulation of loss is nothing. I am, and the simulation of loss is nothing. So the only barriers are these silly obstacles we placed on our way of thinking we need to learn these lessons. We don't. Let's see what else comes up. Any more foreshadowing? But it's amazing, the foreshadowing. Maybe it's been happening for you. It's fours are showing up everywhere. Black darkness is showing up everywhere. Getting fortunately, I had those gloves on, or else I would have gotten all over my hands, you know, and it would have been terrible. The hands would have been all stained with blackness, but I had the gloves on, which is symbolic also, meaning there's a way to sidestep it, to remain untouched by it. And the barriers are that just habit. We're so used to this, to believing that we need these lessons. We're so used to that, it's so difficult for us to wake up and say, whoa, we've been in this incredible nonsense for so long. We've been just in this eccentric, totally eccentric nightmare for no reason. All in vain hope of becoming prime creator, finding a way. blaming mine, you know, for the failure. I want to get it done fast. And of course, mine can't do the impossible, can't make us prime creator, but it can tell us this tall tale of how it plausibly is possible. Plausible. We or accept our own annihilation plausibly, that causes a resurrection from annihilation. But it's all nonsense. There's no reality to it. So we've just been in this belief for so long. It's hard to disbelieve it. You know, we're habituated to believing it. Suspending our reason. We've been suspending our reason here for so long. What I found in coming into the world, people had no reason. They were all suspending their reason. I tried to reason with people and couldn't do it. And they didn't have any. They're suspending their reason. And then I had to turn to the Holy Spirit and get my reason restored. You know, it's so hard in this world to have any reason at all, because people literally don't use reason. They use belief. They suspend reason. Reason would easily show you what's going on here. So the only way to believe in what's going on here is suspend reason and not really use it, and substitute intellect for reason, figuring, you know, figures and measurement and that, you know, that kind of stuff. Intellect is to suspend reason and offer this fake substitute for it that we haven't, that they teach in school now. That's the only way. So it's very hard to teach in this world, to use reason and explain it, because people have suspended their reason. They say, I don't know, how can I understand this? They say, how can I understand this? I don't know how to. Because only reason can understand it. A suspended reason can't understand it, of course not. So don't expect suspended reason to understand what's being said here. Only reason understands it. But it's for reason, it's a piece of cake. See, suspended reason is struggling, saying, I can't get this, it's too difficult. Well, just, it's like saying someone with their eyes closed is trying to, you know, drive cross country, and they're saying, my God, this is so difficult, it's so difficult, I can't even get out of the driveway. How do you expect me to drive across country? I say, well, open your eyes. And they open their eyes, and they say, oh, a piece of cake, I can do that. I'll drive to the store or somewhere. So, as long as one suspends reason, it's going to seem to be impossible. But when one decides to use reason, they'll say, oh, this is easy. I can understand this. Simple, very simple. And of course, reason is suspended in order to keep believing that this can work. Keep believing in the tall tales that mind is telling us. Because we want to be prime creator. The cost of that is suspend reason, and therefore believe in this ridiculous tall tale that mind is telling us, and continue to suffer loss, trauma, loss, and trying to learn how to accept our own annihilation. That's the price we pay for wanting to be prime creator. And God is not forcing this price on us. It is an intrinsic, inherent price of this idea. There's no way around it. In order for reality to be real and remain real, there's no way that we can have this idea of changing it be experienced. It's impossible. So we do have this terrible suffering and suspension of reason, and we don't understand what's going on. We just remain trapped like lemmings, and, you know, trapped rats here, suffering all these horrible miseries and misfortunes and loss, etc. All the while just feeling like we're helpless. We can't do anything about it. We can't understand it. We bleed out saying, God, why are you doing this to us? You know, why are you so terrible, God? And we don't understand. Why are you punishing us? Why did you send this tornado and kill some and others? Why did you do? It's all nonsense, of course. It's not using reason at all. God's not doing any of this to us. We're doing it to ourselves. We are doing all of this to ourselves. All loss, etc., is doing it to ourselves out of our desire to be prime creator, to change reality. And then mind has no choice but to present this scenario of loss to try and teach us how to accept our own annihilation. That's what we're doing to ourselves. So don't blame God for anything. Don't blame mind for anything. Don't blame God for anything. Spirit needs to forgive itself, repent, forgive itself for choosing this eccentric idea. And again, nobody listening to this with suspended reason can understand it. It will remain vague and upsetting and struggling and confusing. But if you're willing to engage reason, you'll say, hey, this is just 1 + 1 = 2. It's very simple. I don't have any trouble with it. I don't have any trouble at all. A piece of cake is completely plain and obvious. So it's only a matter of willingness to use reason, and that's why the Holy Spirit helps you. What the Holy Spirit does when you ask for the help, it simply begins to convince you to engage your reason. Engage your reason to the point where you can see the situation as it is. And you say, oh, that's very simple. No worries. Because we have we've habituated to not using reason for so long, it seems very tough for us. It's like an atrophied limb or something. We've been in a wheelchair forever, and we're told we can walk, and we say, what are you talking about? It's too difficult. I can't do this. So you got to take little steps and gradually feel like you're reactivating your reason, even though it's so simple. You could get it right now, but you feel like, oh, it must be super difficult. So I'm going to do a little bit of time. So the Holy Spirit's totally patient, gradually gets you to reactivate your reason, to use it, and then you'll see what's being said here is totally simple, piece of cake for you. And you'll say, oh, of course, no worries. I can exchange simulations. I can exchange the simulation of loss for the simulation of no loss. And I can sidestep all these crazy lessons in accepting the annihilation of spirit to come. I can sidestep all those. I don't need any lessons of loss whatsoever. Simple. Reason says no problem. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.